We finally made it. After a long journey, we've managed to make a Minecraft clone that is playable, with its own identity and a stable foundation that will prepare it for more development in the future. I have decided to call the game Cosmic Reach, after many name considerations, being unique, matching in theme, having ties to the story I've planned. And to top it all off, it rhymes with my username. Thank you everyone for your name suggestions. Seeing you propose different ones along with explanations on why it could be used helped me to narrow down as to the essence of what makes a good name, as it was no easy task to do alone. Before we continue with our usual devlogue talking about the challenges along the way, I'll tell you how you can try the pre-alpha right now. There's two ways you can get the game. The recommended way is to go to itch.io/app and download the Itch Launcher, which will update the game automatically. Then copy and paste the link finalforreach.itch.io/cosmicreach in the description into the launcher and press install. Select your platform and confirm the install. After it is done downloading, launch the game and the game will run. On Linux, if the app doesn't run, add the no sandbox argument to the Itch launcher and it should run fine. Alternatively, if you don't want to use the launcher, you can download the game directly using the same link. Also, if you want to discuss the game, report bugs, give feedback, and share screenshots, I have a Discord. The link is also in the description. Now on with the devlog. How did we get to this point of release? Well, from the last video, we had no way to save the game properly, which is essential if people are going to play it. In order to save, we need to plan out the file format as to match our needs. Normally, it's fine to use a human-readable format such as JSON, which is easy to extend. However, we are dealing with a huge amount of blocks and lighting information, so we should make our own binary format to avoid the large overhead involved with a text format. We have the world divided into regions already for a quick frustum column, so we can reuse this to write a file per region. Writing regions instead of chunks avoids creating hundreds of thousands of files, putting excess strain on the file system. The region format is as follows. We start with a magic number, which is an arbitrary 4-byte number that can be read by the program to instantly recognize whether or not it is the correct file type. Then we have the file version. We start with 0, and every time we need to make a change to the format, we add 1 to this. This way, we can convert old files into new versions and later versions of the game. Then we have a number signifying the compression type. At the moment, we don't have any file-level compression, such as deflate, so we have it set at 0, so that in the future, we can override this with a different number that tells the program what is the correct way to uncompress it. Next, we have a table of 4096 integers, each corresponding to a chunk in the region. These integers represent where in the file the chunk is actually defined. This means that we don't have to scan the entire file and load the entire region just to get a single chunk. After the table is the actual data for the chunks. Each chunk starts with an integer that says how many bytes are written for the data. Then the chunk also saves the file version. This is useful because we may want to partially update chunks from an older file version without needing to convert the entire file. Then the chunk coordinates are saved, which are used for validation while loading. After this, we save the block data, which can be either a single block for the entire chunk, or layered data, write in an integer with the value 1 or 2, respectively. If it is a single block, then it writes a string representing the block state. If it is a layered chunk, it writes the individual layers with their different representations. I won't go into the details, but the idea is essentially, whenever we have different implementations, we write a number indicating which to use, and then the underlined data, all the way until you get the actual bytes. The same concept is repeated for lighting data as well. So now we have the file formats we need to save, but not on the main thread, otherwise the game will stutter. When we unload a chunk by moving away from it, we save the region that the chunk was in. But if a chunk has already been saved, we don't have to do anything at all. When saving the region, we load binary data for chunks already written so they are not forgotten on the next save, and we only overwrite them if the chunks exist in memory. There's two more occasions on which we save the game, once every 3 minutes, and on pausing the game. However, saving naively from memory without any file level compression means that each region takes a huge amount of storage. Saving everything in a 48 chunk render distance means a save data of 250 megabytes. That's way too large, but there's an easy way to drastically reduce this. Remember how in the first episode we separated chunks into layers, so that if all the blocks are the same, it only stores a single block, and how later we use nibbles instead of bytes to represent blocks and lighting values wherever possible? During the generation and lighting process, as it shapes the world, the representation can become redundant, using more data than needed. When we save individual chunks, we can tell it to scan the chunk to represent it in the smallest possible way. This reduces the file size by a factor of 10. The same world saved before is now around 25 megabytes. And because of this reduction, chunks are loaded in memory in the smaller footprint, meaning we free more memory and there is less garbage collection the next time the game is loaded. When the game generates the world for the first time, it used to pop the player at a fixed position up in the air, since we didn't know what the terrain would look like. We need to set a proper spawn location, but we have to wait for the nearby chunks to be loaded first, and we can't have the player without a spawn point. Enter the loading screen. Eye candy to keep the player waiting while the world loads. The game doesn't start until it loads 12 chunks, and stays on the loading screen until then. After you load the game, it's pretty quick at around a second, but also prove useful in the future for loading multiplayer lobbies. At the bottom, I put text in homage to the loading text in Spore. Also, there's no secrets here, so don't try to find them. Although there was plenty more I accomplished since the last video, this covers the major roadblocks to release. So now let's look at the comments. Will it run on Mac or 32-bit computers? In the case that you are not running 64-bit Windows or Linux, you can download the JAR file version instead. I have not tried it out on those systems, but your computer needs to support OpenGL 3, and you will need to install Java 17 at the minimum in order to run it. If you run 64-bit Windows or Linux, however, you won't have to install anything outside of the itch app. What about the Steam Deck? I tried it on a borrowed Steam Deck using the Linux version, and it works well performance-wise. But there's significant battery drain and the controls didn't work at all. I will need to buy one for myself to make sure it works well. There should be particles when breaking blocks. I agree. I didn't have time to add a particle system yet, but there's breaking and placing noises for blocks now, which gives just a little bit of life to the gameplay. On main menus. I asked you guys on what makes a good main menu and I got some pretty useful responses. It needs good music, should look aesthetically pleasing, and have dynamic elements to it that reflect the gameplay or story in some way. Mine needs a lot of improvement. It's functional and it took me a bit of effort to make it look at least presentable. But I think, as the gameplay evolves, there'll be more inspiration to draw from the game itself, as to make a fitting main menu. I'd like to take a moment to thank everyone who has joined me on this journey. None of this would have been possible without your support. Thank you for suggesting themes, mechanics, names, ideas, and performance tips, creating discussion and constructive criticism, which I took all to heart. Even when I know some suggestions won't be added, the underlying reasoning behind these comments were vital in guiding me to make the best possible plan for the game. We're just getting started, and I'll continue to keep an ear out as to what you have to say. I'd also like to thank all those who prayed for me. When I asked this, I was in a terrible state, and while I will always have the same chronic health issues, I thank God I'm far better now. Of course, we need to be grateful for what we have while we still have it. On a less serious note, this may be the finale of the series, but it's not the end of the devlogs. I will now continue developing according to player feedback, and my focus will be oriented towards that. We'll see if the devlog structure changes at all from here. In a week's time from this video coming out, I'll put out a YouTube poll as to the next big focus of the game development, so listen carefully to the options now. Option 1, multiplayer. Option 2, a redstone-like system. Or, option 3, infinite world height and depth. All of these options have their challenges and will be added eventually, but playing it for a week should give you time to consider which should come sooner. I will also start making parts of my code open source with a permissive MIT license, specifically the save system to allow for external editing tools. The rest of my code, however, will wait until I make a proper license for it, which isn't as simple as copy-pasting one that already exists. If you want to tag along with me on this journey in the making of Cosmic Reach, then stay tuned. Take care, and I'll see you next time.